whole room of alcohol. I have, you know.
The problem with doing that is like a blood flow. It's actually surprisingly common eye surgery. They have to basically take part of the company's
It's one of those I can read about it as well.
Do not go to the facility.
Hey, Nydia, how are you today?
Hey, Jim.
Hey.
We're getting ready to start in just a couple of minutes.
Hey, Jim.
Hi, Jim.
Hey,
John. Yes.
Hey, Carol.
How are you?
She does that.
She's a stalker.
Yeah, you can. Let's see. Yeah, grab a seat down there for a minute. Yeah, come up here in a minute. You can talk to the answer. Come sit there.
Good afternoon, Ms. Boff.
Vince with a B, right? His name's right.
Hello, can you hear us?
James with Vince.
Sir?
Is this it, James?
Yes, sir.
Hello, Jim.
Once,
or
I think
we've
been
on
the
phone.
Yes,
sir.
Cindy,
around these.
Yeah. So, Council, we have one commissioner on the telephone.
Director. We have a physical quorum present. Commissioner Boff, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Where are you located?
I am in St. Augustine, Florida.
That is out of the jurisdiction, most decidedly. So, yes, he can participate by phone.
Yes, sir. So I'd like to call the July 7th, 2015 work session to order at 2:02. So if everyone can stand, please, and we recite the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, everyone. Been out this lovely afternoon. Item 3, are there any changes to today's agenda? Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Boff?
No, sir.
Mr. Merritt?
No,
County?
Sir.
County Attorney?
Mr. Chairman, I do have some.
Some or a little?
Just two. Mr. Chairman, with respect to item number 4, which is the board consideration of certain modifications to the civil service policies, I would request that be postponed to the next work session in July. I'm not quite ready for that.
No move. That would be
July 28th.
Second. Motion second to move item 4 to July 28th work session. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Carries 5-0. Counselor?
Mr. Chairman, yes, I'd request on a time-sensitive basis the board consider adding an item to the agenda, and that would be just a discussion of some potential UDC modifications related to certifications we're requiring on final plats.
So moved, Council.
I'll discuss it with Nydia.
Item 19.
Yes, sir.
Have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Carries 5-0. Anything else, Council?
No, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Do I hear a motion to adopt the agenda as amended?
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Carries 5-0. Item 4. First thing is board consideration of 2.2% cost of living adjustment for library staff. Retroactive July 1st. Jon McDaniel here. Speak on this.
I know Lyle and I will answer y'all's questions, but we had spoke with Doug and he said because y'all's COLA for the county was part of the salary study package, he recommended that we come before you to request that the library employees also be included in the 2.2% COLA that was given to the county staff. And so in the past, that we've always been made part of the budget in the budgetary process, but I understand that with the salary study it was handled differently this year, but we are requesting that our library staff be included in that 2% COLA just as they have with merits as well as COLAs in the past.
Any questions about this?
Do we have numbers?
$77,300, correct, Mr. Good?
Mr. Gruen, you've got funding?
We have a budget resolution to take this funding out of the general fund contingency and add it to the library payments.
Any other questions?
Yeah, why? How come it got pulled out? They just
our salary study didn't include it, correct, John?
We were not part of the salary study.
But I wonder why. No. That makes no sense.
Because they're not employees of the county. They do not operate on payroll.
State.
Actually, we're employees of the library board, which is a funded agency of you guys. We only have three state payments.
But all of the salaries do come out of the county.
Majority of them.
Yeah, they're not part of our classification study or process through payroll or anything.
But they do a great job.
No, I know. And they come out of our majority comes out of our funding anyways. Because they're not.
Yes.
Okay. Any other questions? And basically, this is a two-part thing. We have to approve the retroactive, then we have to approve the resolution part.
And this just aligns them with all the other county employees we already approved.
So do I hear a motion for the COLA increase?
So moved.
Second. Motion second to approve the 2.2 COLA retroactive July 1st.
January
1st, I'm sorry.
So I tried too hard, John. So do we need to do that time sensitive?
I don't think so, do we?
Well, I assume it'd be approved in the next week.
Contingent.
So okay, put it on contingent.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, now do I hear a motion to approve the resolution?
So moved.
That's presented in our book.
Second.
Motion second to approve the resolution authorizing money to come out of the general fund. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Carries 5-0. Thank you, John.
Thank you.
That was quick and painless.
Hopefully.
Took a little while to get here.
Thank y'all. Item 2, Mr. Fraley.
Without any instructions on off,
yes, sir.
Chairman. Just by way of introduction, first of all, last week we published our comprehensive annual financial report known as the CAFR, distributed to the board and is publicly available for our fiscal year ending December 31st, 2014. Today, our audit firm who helped us audit this CAFR and help us put some of the numbers together usually comes and makes a presentation as actually required, I think, by their audit standards directly to the Board of Commissioners. Adam Fraley is usually the partner that comes, and he usually comes with James Benz, who is the director over our audit. And today, Adam decided to let James fly solo. So if I can introduce James Benz to you, he will go. We also distributed the audit discussion book to each of your places. James promised me he will not go through all 30-some pages of narrative and 60 pages of entries, but they'll hit the high points of the audit and the fiscal year. James?
Thank you, Dave. Good afternoon, members of the board. As you mentioned, my name is James Spence. I'm a director with Mauldin and Jenkins. I've worked and was in charge of managing the county's audit this past year. I do not intend to read all 30 pages to you. It's fun reading if you have some time later. Just to hit a few highlights in there, if you look on page 2, and I'm mainly going through our audit discussion and audit results memo that was laid on your desk this afternoon. Page 2 just gives you a little bit of information about our firm for those of you who may not know much about us. We provide audit services for about 300 governments throughout the Southeast, and 75 of those governments have been awarded the GFOA Certificate of Achievement, which the county has also received in the past and has applied for the 2014 audit. Page 3 gives a little more information about other services our firm provides. The biggest niche we do have is our government service industry, but there's some other services we provide just for background for you all. On page 4, one of the things we like to point out is the preparation of the financial statements is management's responsibility, the responsibility of the county. And as the independent auditors, it's our responsibility to come in and audit those financial statements and be able to provide an opinion on the material accuracy of those statements. And we performed our audit within generally accepted auditing standards, as well as those standards required by governmental auditing standards. And based on our testing, we were able to issue an unmodified opinion, which is also known as a clean opinion, which states that the information in the financial statements is materially correct as it's presented. One thing to note, it's at the bottom of the page, the county was required to and did implement GASB number 67, which changes the disclosure, the note requirements for your pension plan. And then next year, the county will be required to implement GASB 68, which deals with the accounting for the pension plan. So 67 has been implemented and is included in the financial statements as is required. And 67 and 68 are kind of the big plans that everybody's been talking about for the past couple of years. Flipping to page 7, going through about page 12, are just some graphical information on your general fund, which is the county's main operating fund, as well as the overall performance of the county this past year. That just gives you some historical trends to look at just for your information. Pages 12 through 14 are what we call kind of the Cliff Notes version. Obviously, in your financial statements, you have the footnotes, and the footnotes can be rather long. This kind of summarizes the information that is in each footnote. If you're looking for anything in particular, you can kind of come here to figure out which notes you want to look in. Going to page 16, I am happy to say that during the course of our audit, we did not have any significant difficulties working with the finance department. Dave and his team do a great job of getting us information and allowing us to be able to give our opinion on the financial statements, as well as get them issued within the state required amount of time. We did have several audit adjustments in the audit. Those are included in the audit agenda package that you have, and they start at page 30 and run through the end of the document. Those have been posted to the county system and are included in the financial statements. Those are just in there as required disclosure to the board. Flipping to page 18, as a result of some of the audit entries that we've had this year, there were a few findings from those. Those are included on pages 18 and 19. Those have been discussed with management, and again, they're resulting from audits that have been posted and are included in the financial statement, so those aren't unaccounted for differences. That's just results of adjustments that occurred during the audit. Page 20 through 21, those are what we call our management points. Those are just byproducts of the audit, just recommendations. They're not significant issues, but they're things that might help the county streamlining processes or improving activities. So those have all been provided to management, again, discussed with management. And then pages 23 through 26, we kind of just give a little highlight information on some of the accounting standards that are new for this year, the 2014 year, as well as those coming in future years. Just to make sure that not only management, but as well as the board is aware of these changes coming. Obviously, the decisions you all make have implications on the accounting side of things. So this just gives you a little information, a little background as to some of those standards. And as with anything in here, if you read through this or if you look at it, you have any questions, whether it's now or at another time, always feel free to reach out. We'd be happy to help address any questions you all have on those. Page 27, the last thing I want to point out is our firm does offer free continuing education classes. covering a various array of topics dealing with accounting issues for governments. Those are offered to not only management, but also members of the boards. If you all have any interest in obtaining CPE or sitting in on any of these topics that might have some impact on the county's reporting, there's an email address on page 28. You can be added to our email list, and every time we come up with a class, we'll email out what the topic will be and allow you to sign up. So if you have any interest in sitting in on one of those or just being having the option to determine if you want to at a later time, feel free to email us and get on our mailing list. With that, if you all have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them at this time.
Any questions from the board? Mr. Gruen, are you happy with the audit?
I think we ended up in a good place. A lot of effort, a lot of people, and working closely with the firm. And I think everyone that worked together did a good job to produce the final CAFR.
Thank you, sir. This is only a presentation of the thing. It's not for us to approve today.
We're required to make a presentation to the board.
Any other questions from the board? Thank you, Mr. Gruen. Thank you, sir.
Thank you all.
Glad to have y'all doing our work.
Thank you.
Keep us at AAA. Item 3, Mr. Ryan.
Yes, sir.
A time sensitive grant.
Sir, item 3 is a request for approval from the Sheriff's Office to apply to the State of Georgia Criminal Justice Coordinating Council for the 2015 Victims of Crime Act grant program for up to $40,702 with the required match of $10,176 and authorization for the chairman to execute any related grant application documents. If awarded, this grant will be used to offset the costs to sheriff's office deputies that work with the witness unit. We received funding for this program for at least 10 years. We work is here. If there's any specific questions about the department that we pay you or
any questions about this grant? Do I hear a motion from the board? I make a motion to approve the Sheriff's Office to apply to the State of Georgia Criminal Justice Coordinating Council for the 2015 Victims of Crime Act grant program for up to $40,702 with required match of $10,176 with the chairman authorized to sign any applications.
Second.
Motion second for approval.
Time sensitive.
Any questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Carries 5-0. Number 4, Mr. Boff has moved to July 28th work session. On number 5, our charity.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. This is a request for the Board of Commissioners to reappoint Terry Smith as the elected official representative for a 4-year term to the Forsyth County Civil Service Board. His current term will expire July 20th, 2015. And in your backup documentation, you'll just see that there was a letter to the county manager showing that the election was held in compliance with Civil Service Board Policy 2.
Okay. Any question about Terry Smith? David, will we have a motion?
Make a motion. We approve the reappointment of Terry Smith as elected official representative.
Second.
Motion second to reappoint Terry Smith. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Carries 5-0.
Thank you.
Item 6, Mr. Gurin.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. Just a brief summary for this sort of a ministerial type thing we need to do as we begin the annual impact fee update report process. As we do each year, we put together an entire report, including update of the short-term work program and the capital improvements element. So this is how we kick it off each year. We just need to have the board authorize setting public hearing on August 6th. And before that date, we'll have the whole report put together, be available for the public and the board. And we start with that process. That's one where the board, as of that hearing, allows us to pass resolution and transmit it to GMRC, and DCA reviews it, and when they approve it, that keeps our whole impact fee program in compliance with the state guidance. And that's it. Just need to set the public hearing.
Any questions?
Now, I know we're looking at
the impact board.
And do we
are we charging enough for our impact fee? Now, will this be where we, if we're not charging enough, we will raise it?
Not this process. This is okay. More of the historical, it's more of the report. Although, okay. Where the two will really intersect a little bit is, this is the place where, since the board updates their capital improvement element, the short-term work program, in other words, what capital facilities are in there. The impact fee study itself and the levy of the fees, one of the components to that is the types of facilities, the cost, and the things that are in the plan. So having this in place each year is important to levy the impact fees, including the study we're doing.
So, but if our study comes back and it says that we can charge more for impact fees, mm-hmm. then won't we need to adjust and put more things in it?
Well, it's only certain things you can put in.
But I'm saying if it says that we need to charge more, you know, like if say whatever right. we're charging now, if we can charge more, won't that create more items to go in it?
We'll have to look at the details when we get those, because the reason might be charging more. The reason why I could come up with a higher fee is that costs have risen. Again, it's right. based on our program. We might need that increased fee to cover what's in the program, let alone adding additional things. So
right.
it'll depend when we get to that point.
Okay.
It's also ready to get some more fields under the park system for the right. new demand coming.
Right.
It's already based on parks. Any other questions about
the library and lots of other things?
Advertise for a public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Motion second to advertise for a public hearing August 6, 2015. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Carries 5-0. 7A, award of following bids. That's done. This first A is time sensitive.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. This is for a purchase of some vehicles for the sheriff's office, and this was providing our capital projects list. At this time, we're asking to purchase three of the 2015 Ford Interceptor sedans from Billy Howell Ford in the amount of $74,147.82. The reason it's time sensitive is we have to place the order by the 10th of this month to get the 2015 units. There were other items that we did bid out. 2015, they're no longer available, so we will be rebidding those for the 2016 pricing. And the other item I'd like to bring to your attention, this does fall under the local business initiative. Thank you.
So this number may change?
No, sir.
No, this?
Not for this one. We'd come back to the board for the other ones, yes, sir.
For the one in 2016? We set price this. Was he over or under, or did for that local initiative?
He was over.
He was over, but
he was less than the 5%, though, so that's why good. We'd recommend that.
Any questions?
Make a motion to award bid C15-73-2210 for the three 2015 Ford Interceptor sedans from Billy Howell Ford Lincoln Inc. in the amount not to exceed $74,147.82. Time sensitive.
Second, time sensitive.
We have a motion and a second for time sensitive item A for approval. Any other discussion? Questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Bob? Jim?
Aye.
Okay, gotcha. Motion carries 5-0. Don't be down at the beach doing this call in now. Item 7B.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. This is for award of bid C15-74-2210. And this is for Dodge Charger. These are the pursuit vehicles for the sheriff's office. Again, this was in our capital projects list. We had a total of, I believe it was 26 vehicles. I'm sorry, just one moment. I want to make sure I'm giving you the right number. And we wanted to increase it to 31 if possible, if the board approves it. It is within their budgeted amount for these vehicles. And the reason being is that the pricing came in a little bit more advantageous to the county. We would like to award this to Allen J. GM Superstore in the amount of $707,172. I would like to point out that these are two 2014 model vehicles that they have on their lot currently that we can get immediately. Thank you.
This is up to 31?
Yes, this is for 31.
Yes, it is for 31.
Yes, it is for 31, sir.
This is out of the total 56 are approved, correct?
Yes. Okay. That is correct.
Okay. Any other questions? Did I hear a motion from the board?
Sir, I couldn't do my
motion.
No. That's good.
Okay. Make the motion to award bid C15-74-2210 for the Dodge Charger Pursuit vehicles for the Sheriff's Office as presented in our book not to exceed the $707,172.
Up to 31 cars.
The 31 cars. Is this time sensitive of those cars?
No.
Okay. Second.
Now, motion second for approval item B. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Motion carries 5-0. Item C, Doc.
Thank you. The next item is for award of bid 15-64-2410, and this is for a replacement of a concrete apron at the fire department. Their current area has been well worn. We'd like to recommend award to Blunt Construction in the amount of $61,000. They do have this budgeted. Thank you.
Thank you, Doc. Any questions about fire department?
Yeah, where is that? Is this going?
Down by their maintenance facility.
Do I hear a motion?
Make the motion that we award bid 15-64-2410 for the concrete apron replacement from Blount Construction Company, Inc., and the amount not to exceed $61,000 as presented.
Second.
Motion and second for approval item C. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries 5-0. Item A.
Thank you. This is for the purchase of the digital in-car video camera systems, and this is also for the sheriff's office. This is for the vehicles that have been approved in their in the capital project, and these were anticipated in their in the total cost that was approved. Approval to purchase with L3 Mobile Vision in the amount of $260,640. Please note that we are going with L3 because that is what their infrastructure currently is, and so we would be. We're staying with the same infrastructure. They also are including body cameras at no additional charge. Thank you.
How many body cameras?
50.
Oh, thank you.
Those are interesting devices. Mm-hmm. You have to be careful about to do this.
Okay. Any other discussion about item 8? Do we hear a motion for item 8?
Make a motion that we approve the flashback 3 digital in-car video camera systems for the sheriff's office, the L3 Mobile Vision Flashback 3 digital video car camera systems, the 50 replacement. Well, maybe I didn't do that right.
Yeah, you did.
Just
like in about.
And the amount not to exceed $260,640 as presented in our books.
So. Motion second for approval item 8 as presented. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries 5-0. Item 9, Donna.
Thank you. This next item is for approval of a task order with Black and Veatch for design and engineering of the various pipeline areas that are in our water and sewer capital improvement program, our CIP. Black and Veatch is one of our on-call engineering firms, and they are well suited to provide this work. You will see we have it for CIP number 102, 103, 107, 108, and 112. Also included in this cost is, which is $732,561, there is also a not to exceed amount of $200,000, and that is to provide the water and sewer department for on-site inspection during construction of the projects if needed. Tim, I didn't know if you wanted to add anything to that or not.
We don't know today if we'll need it or not. We do have an open project manager position we've been unable to fill. We've got a lot of projects going. It just depends on how many are hitting at the same time. But these are large diameter critical pipeline projects, and typically on something of this size, you'd have on-site inspection and project management. So we wanted to get it approved with this in here, but we would not use it unless it's needed. It'd just be it's an allowance, is that's right.
That's right. It's not to exceed amount.
And this would be for inspection services during construction.
That's an outside firm?
It's the same company.
It's the same company.
Black
so
they would provide, along with the engineering and the bid assistance. And
they have their own person who inspects the road.
They would have a project manager, engineer tech provide
it. Work. It's not?
Yeah.
It would be, this company would design the work, then we bid it out to a contractor. This inspector would inspect the contractor.
To make sure they're following their engineer design.
Correct. Correct.
That
correct.
Makes sense.
That's right.
This is just for the design.
And field conditions as much as anything. When you're laying pipelines, that's where you get.
Where you get.
the proper air patching and the proper level.
Okay, any other discussion? Do I hear a motion on item 9? I make a motion to accept the task order with Black and Veatch Corporation amount not to exceed $732,561 for the CIP pipeline projects listed.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Carries 5-0. Item 10.
Thank you. This next item is a request to just amend our current agreement with Mauldin Altobelli. They currently have our project management contract for our SPLOS project with our engineering department. If you remember a few weeks ago, it was approved to have them help with our water and sewer department for some design of water and sewer lines because of the same roads that they were working on to have it all conceptually done. The other item is that the engineering department would like to be able to use them for at least two projects that are currently under our transportation bond projects. So we'd like to respectfully ask to add those services to the agreement. It would be under the same pricing we have. One item for the amendment would be to add a senior inspector for the water and sewer inspections to the current rate list that is provided in our contract. And the second item would be to allow to add transportation bond projects to this agreement if necessary. Thank you.
So moved. Second. There's a motion and a second to approve item 10. For Mauldin Altobelli. For the SPLOS program management services. Any other questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Carries 5-0. Item 11, Mr. Perkins.
This is a Department of Transportation agreement. Similar as we've done in the past, where they are going to provide the construction of the relocated water lines along Bethelview Road as part of their project. And it's the correct term, that's what they call these things. Yeah. Didn't really matter, I guess, about the actual title of this document, but it's a contract with the DOT. They'll bid the water line relocation out as part of the project, and we have to reimburse them 100% for that. This is being funded, I believe. I'll give we sent this up to finances. Should be being funded out of SPLOS funds.
SPLOS 6. Just one question. How close are we to bid this Bethview project? Tim Perkins?
Scheduled let dates August 21st right now.
August 21st to September?
How'd you work that out?
We're good.
Good boy.
Any questions about waterline relocation with the state? Do I hear a motion?
A motion approved. The contract item agreed with George GDOT, the waterline relocation of Duffelton Road from Castleberry Road to State Route 20, the road widening project as displayed on the vote.
Second. Any other questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? It carries 5-0. Mr. Perkins, when do they start doing this waterline relocation?
It'll be part of the whoever wins the road project, and they'll coordinate. That's what takes the difficulty out of it. It's the same contractor. He'll probably have a subcontract with a waterline contractor, and you know, he may do phases as he's done some grading. Mm-hmm. Other areas he may be able to go in ahead of time, so it'll really be up to the contractor who was awarded the project to schedule it and get it done.
I'm sure Todd and I will have plenty of calls when I think it started.
Do you mind if I say you're smarter than me because you're the chairman and give your money?
You might remember too, this is a few months ago or weeks ago, y'all gave us permission to correct up our boundary with the city of Cummins. Yeah. So we no longer have customers on both sides. That's going to simplify part of this where we won't have services crossing Bethelview Road.
Okay. Item 12. County initiated rezoning from A1 to CBD, property located on 5840 Alpharetta Fossil. Mr. Boff, Mr. Levent, Commissioner Levent, what are we doing here?
Oh, this should be the parcel that was touched the other day. It was interesting. It came to see me, and I don't know all of the details, so is anybody here on this one?
Yeah.
In the family?
I am.
Would you like to cover all the details and how long they've been paying on CBD property?
Be glad to. I wrote a letter to you guys. It wasn't included in the book, but essentially the Powells have owned this property since the 60s. They've been using the front 1.14 acres of a narrow 5-acre piece of property as CBD, and have been taxed as far back as the tax records indicate, according to Mary Kirkpatrick. So until this year, they thought they were CBD on that front 1.14 acres. The zoning staff reached out to them and informed them that they were no longer CBD on that front 1.14, and they would now be zoned and taxed as A1. They do have a legal non-conforming use there now, but they didn't even find out. Actually, they didn't even find out about the change until they tried to expand their business. People out there, and they couldn't get a business license because of that fact. So they're just asking that they get what they thought they always had, and change nothing, really.
What is the legal non-conforming use now?
Right now, it's a landscaping type thing. They have a pine straw out there for people to come pick up. They have a small building on the property. That's really it. It's right beside a car dealership.
How many acres?
5 acres.
So it's next to CBD also?
It's next to CBD and surrounded by commercial, but it's also next to another A1 piece, but it doesn't look like there's no house out there.
It's a skinny piece of land, but the whole thing's about 5 acres. Dirt on Highway 9, right on State Highway 9. Right across from the Goodyear down there.
In your book.
In the front little piece, the 1.1 acres they've been using for CBD forever and paying for it for those tax records go back. And they went to go expand, and they're saying, well, that's not even CBD. And they're saying, well, yes, it is. You've been charging us this way all these years. So all they're asking for is a piece that they've been using as the 1.14 that allow us to have a CBD as you've been charging us all this time. And they're not asking for the rest of it.
Just one point the front acreage.
Which is what they've been charged.
How do we have a description in the map? You know, Christopher, in the tax map compared to the zoning map?
On the tax map, now it's described as A1.
I know, but
before it was 1.14 was CBD.
Yeah, CBD.
It was always taxed like that, and the tax records showing that allocation should be in your book. Mm-hmm. I provided those. If not, I have them here.
Hard to believe they don't get the right to CBD and they've been charged with the county all this year.
Well,
so I thought it'd be fair to the county initiated rezoning as well as hopefully to have what they've been paying us for by the year.
Okay.
Mr.
Motion.
Mr. Tam had one of the very same.
Should we just do the whole thing?
They actually, I think, would be okay with all them, but we didn't want to give them more than what they always had.
It's trying to be fair.
Yeah.
I don't know. It doesn't matter to me. But to clear it,
that's what I'm saying. Let's not do it twice. Are they going to object if you?
Do they want the whole thing?
I believe. I mean, I don't think they would object. But when we talked about it with Commissioner Levin, we just talked about doing what they've always had.
I just didn't want to get too deep into it. Just give them what they've been paying for all these years.
Because the other one would be a real rezone.
That's correct.
Because they've been paying
a second parcel.
Yeah, yes. It's a second parcel.
Yes.
We got a survey and cut it.
They also been using it as a commercial, right?
Correct.
Correct.
And they just want to keep that what they thought the zoning was, and they've been charged for all these years.
The 1.4.
Only on the 1.4, not the 5 acres.
Commissioner Levent, just a real quick question. Would it be your expectation that any zoning would be conditioned to the present use?
I think that's fair.
I'm just on that. Yeah.
I don't know that it really matters. I mean, does it? Because in the tax records, does it say we're charging you CBD, but only because it's this use only? I mean, is there a difference in
only that if it's without a condition to present use, then they could go to a different use without a.
But they would have to come back to us for that, though. To change the condition, change
the use. Not just unconditioned CBD. Well,
maybe if we're going to send it to public hearing, we should add some reasonable conditions to it. I don't know.
Again, that's another for another day.
Something we could talk about as it goes there, right? You think they'd have an objection if we come up with reasonable conditions? There's also an overlay down that road as well.
Yeah, fair enough.
I don't know if they know that. There's already an overlay down there.
They have had several uses on that property in the past before all this came up. So it's, I presume that different uses would want, you know, they would want the ability to have different uses.
Yeah, I don't want to limit that because they have the overlay. It's going to really hold them to a lot of building standards and a lot of stuff.
Understood.
Okay, Commissioner
Lynch,
do we have a motion for it?
Yeah, I make a motion that we do a county initiated rezoning from A1 to CBD on a property located at 5840 Atlanta Highway, a parcel 018-048, for the amount of land in which should be shown as 1.34 acres to rezone this property CBD.
Second. Yeah.
Motion second for county initiated rezoning on item 12. Any other discussion with the Powell family? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
We're just starting public hearing, not
yeah.
Really.
Carries 5-0. Item 13. Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. We have for your consideration today three additional policies from the animal shelter. If you will allow me, I would like to pass out slightly revised, just pass that down. It should be, if you'll take one and pass it down, please.
Oh, here.
I want to give you a
couple of years. I'll give it to
Mr. Boff.
Mr. Boff, you got yours?
He's asleep on the beach.
He's back on the beach again. You with us, Jim? Go ahead.
All right, so these are three policies from the animal shelter staff and the advisory committee. The first one is a policy regarding vehicle maintenance. The second is a policy on staff training. And the third is a policy on owner reclamation or reclaiming. These three policies have been through the Animal Shelter Advisory Committee, and they approved them to come to y'all and ask y'all to support approving these policies.
Do you want that?
Can I hold these things next
to
me? That all these things are necessary just to make them smoother running the shelter. Because like other shelters, they've been challenged with all these barriers, so you come up with the policies to make it easy.
Do we approve all these policies one at a time or in mass? Or all
yes,
three
sir. What you have in your book is a resolution that will adopt and approve all three of these at the same time. I just wanted to be careful that you had the corrected version of each policy. So you have a resolution.
Okay. I hear a motion from the board.
Make a motion to approve the resolution by the Forsyth County Board of Commissioners. Confirming the Forsyth County Animal Shelter's policies regarding vehicle maintenance, staff training, and owner.
Second. Second. Mr. Bob. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries 5-0.
Thank you.
Item 14, County Attorney. We ready to talk about this today?
We are, Mr. Chairman. Could somebody switch the light over there, please? Thank you, board members. Since we started this some time ago in open session, I thought we would probably try to wrap it up in open session, although regrettably, I think we're probably to the point that we could discuss this in executive session as well. But nonetheless, just to go ahead and sort of put the bookend on this discussion, this, of course, involves a piece of property located adjacent to Georgia 400. You may recall that this is based upon some historic GIS maps on the screen, and you'll see all of the buffer area of trees for this long swath adjacent to Georgia 400. At some point, of course, obviously there's billboards, three, in fact, located along this corridor adjacent to Georgia 400. And those billboards were the product of litigation some years ago that resulted in the entry of a consent order and the ability of the entity that prevailed in that litigation to erect those signs, which have been in place for years, along with the buffer there. At some point, the entity, let's see if it indicates on there the actual name, Southern Displays LLP, received a vegetation management permit. As you know, we discussed this at length. This was from the state of Georgia Department of Transportation. It allows basically the pruning back of trees located within GDOT right-of-way, and such a permit was in fact received from Southern Displays LLP. There is a picture of that same area. I'm not suggesting to you that that is the way it looks today. This is the same presentation I made to you some months ago, but I think you get the idea. All of the trees comprising the buffer have been taken down. The Board of Commissioners has attempted to look at this. We had an active code enforcement case. I think code enforcement issued a notice of violation actually in December of last year, and in the process of sort of contemplating what steps to do next, we did in fact try to talk with the owners to decide what there, you know, whether there might be some options rather than just, you know, literally hauling it to court or issuing citations. And that is sort of where we've been. And one of the elements, you may recall, and I think I had come to this work session and told you, was they had indicated they would provide a survey. The notion being that we would then have somebody that would go out and precisely identify where the GDOT right-of-way was, where the signage was located in conjunction with the right-of-way, maybe a description of the work area, etc. And I will tell you that that has been an ongoing process for months. I think you can know that by way of how many times it's been postponed on this agenda. The county has been waiting for that survey, and it's taken quite a bit of time. So let me keep going. Again, just to kind of remember what it used to look like, there's in fact the notice of violation from December of 2014 asking for the buffer to be restored pursuant to the county's UDC, which requires that there be at least a 40-foot buffer, being an undisturbed buffer, along Georgia 400. And of course, you know, you can have the right to take down trees in the Georgia Department of Transportation right-of-way, but that doesn't mean that you can take down trees in private property buffer under our Unified Development Code. This was a mock-up we prepared earlier with respect to the restoration of the buffer, and I think one of the things that, that the county understood was that it would be sort of an expensive undertaking. If you restored that buffer to county buffer standards and got in contact with the county's arborist, that is going to be a little bit of money to try. And candidly, one of the reasons is because can't just the lane. That is a lot of right-of-way. The land, I don't know if this is the landowner position or the Southern Displays position. They are different entities, and I think I want to be very clear on that. The entity that got the vegetation management permit was not the landowner, it was Southern Displays. And I think the primary dialogue we've been having has been with Southern Displays as opposed to the underlying property owner. So perhaps that slide is misplaced. Perhaps it should say that the Southern Displays position has been that all of the pruning or taking down of trees was done with GDOT oversight. That may be true. I'm not in a position to rebut that. One another argument had been made, and this I think is more from the property owner, that they had assisted the county with an emergency water line easement following the 2004 quarry collapse involving Lafarge. And that is true, but I don't know that the board or even my office have been terribly impressed, and that should therefore result in complete cure with respect to the taking down of this buffer. This one, the argument was that we were asking them to basically take, replace scrub pines with high quality plantings, was another argument. And there have been other and additional arguments that I may go over with you at another venue. I will say that with respect to whether or not there was some position at some point that our sewer pipe had never been taken off of the property next to a large quarry. And I think the purpose of this letter in the previous PowerPoint was just to try and show you that we did in fact go in and remove that water line previously and do not believe it is still there. All right, so, and again, this is, okay, so this is the survey that we finally received attempting to show sort of what was going on out there. And I will attempt to decipher it for you the best that I can. As I understand it, I think this is 400 out here. I think this is the property.
best I can tell, I believe I've tried to color code it. I believe this yellow line is generally the GDOT right-of-way boundary. So I think everything here is GDOT right-of-way. I think everything here is on the private property. I also highlighted this orange, as I believe that is depicting by way of the survey a utility or electric utility easement. Best I can tell also is that these blocks that look like almost semi-tractor trailers, those are what they're calling the work area. And then I think you can see these little, hope you can see those little slits that are going forward, look, sort of pointing at the right-of-way. Those, in fact, are the billboards. And I think you can see, probably, well, you may not be able to see it, but the little dot in the middle, that's supposed to be, I believe, the pole. So there are the various poles. What this doesn't really tell us, of course, is it doesn't try to have an overlay depicting the vegetation that was removed. However, I think what it does suggest is there was a lot of work done on the private property that was not done in the right-of-way. And of course, there are some statements. In fact, this survey was accompanied by a letter that came from the attorney for, it says it indicates both Agnes Slack as well as Southern Displays. And the arguments in the letter, obviously it indicates that there's a copy of the survey, the signs, it says are very close to the GDOT property line. But basically argues that irrespective of what kind of cutting was done, that it doesn't represent a violation of our code. One of the main arguments is that because those signs were erected pursuant to court order and a consent order back in whatever that year was, I think it may have been 2004, that we have an obligation to basically set the table for them to be able to do those sorts of cuttings to ensure that the signs, I suppose, are visible from the right-of-way. I'll talk to you about my feelings on that in another venue. So there's more to this letter than just here, but I think the point I want to make to you is this. We have delayed taking action, waiting for the survey to come in. We now have the survey. I think it shows candidly what we suspected all along, and that is there was tree cutting, obviously, on GDOT right-of-way, but there was a lot of cutting along the interior of the property. And I'll just go back and kind of end it where I think we all know, and that is however or whatever the rationale might have been, the entirety of the buffer was mistaken by
all the way to that building,
right? And so, you know, I can talk to you in another forum about whether or not the easement matters or whether or not the proximity of the poles to the but I think it's pretty safe to say, and you can sort of see as I'm holding down this laser, that it looks to me like the fence roughly approximates the GDOT right-of-way boundary. And I think it's pretty evident that there was quite a bit of tree removal on the private property.
Can you go to the next one that shows aerial of the building? So you see the building, you've got the yellow line around the building. Is that a separation of property lines for future other use?
I suspect that is a discrete parcel. I don't know what the potential future use of it is, but I've got to believe that is a separate legal tax parcel.
I'm looking at a cleared area that has an extension of parking lot from that area into the other area.
Right here?
Yeah.
Yes.
Is that required to have additional permits or anything, Mr. Brown, in order to use that for another business on a different piece of property?
Well, and it may have been permitted. Haven't researched that.
Something for you to look at.
Make note of that.
Let me just a few more things before we wrap this up. I'm not going to ask the board to engage in any debate on this, just, and I'll tell you why. First of all, the letter I mentioned that I put up on the screen, the first page of, it is, I believe, it makes a demand of several hundred thousand dollars based upon some permits that it believes the billboard owner, the company, believes have been improperly delayed with respect to this. So I think that there's a insinuation or a clear threat of at least a demand against the county. And there's also, and I guess at the end of the day, what I want to leave you is this. I think the positions of the county and particularly the sign company are going apart, not getting closer. I think that's the real problem. And so I'm going to have to stop there and just commit to you to talk to you more, because the county has some fairly difficult decisions to make with respect to what we're going to do on this. But again, just for purposes of transparency, I thought I would go ahead and do this because we've done it once in the open session, and then I'll get back to you
as far as discussions.
Thank you.
Okay, Council. Thank you. Discussion on item 15. Back to you, Sam. Or you have somebody?
Thank you. John?
Yes.
Me? Basically, these, I don't know if you folks have seen this, but if almost all of SPLOST 7 is guaranteed under the bond on the A list, then surely there's got to be funding for the B list. And so, and each one of us has some project on this B list. I mean, whether it's an intersection improvement, a park improvement, or sidewalk or whatnot. So what I was hoping to do was to move forward with the bike ped section, the old Atlanta Road, and Melody Miser Lane. And I think part of that, Jim, are you still on the phone?
Mr. Boff, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Did you hear that?
Yes, I did, thanks.
Okay, I think part of this goes into you, Ms. Dave Spreek, Melody Miser.
Yes, it does.
So, essentially, I was gonna ask John to go out for design on these projects. They're both voter approved SPLOST 7 category B projects.
And once we design them, we can take them one at a time.
That's
make
right.
sure the money's there.
That's right. And I think probably by the time they get designed, we'll know that A list is done and there's funding for B list.
But where's the design money coming from?
SPLOST 7, John?
Well, Dave can advise. I would say that it should be available in the transportation bond right now, but at some point, hopefully, SPLOST 7 funds would be available for these projects.
Did you hear that, Mr. Bob?
If it's funded through the bond project under traffic safety improvements, then you would have additional money left in SPLOST if the B money comes in to fund these projects. But if not, you'd still be able to build these projects with transportation bond funds if the board desires to move forward with them now.
Are you just bringing up the bike ped stuff too?
Right now?
First part of it. Mr. Boff, did you hear that?
Yes, I did. Thank you.
Did that answer your question?
Yeah.
Dave, are you up?
Right. We SPLOST 7, I mean, there's an improved list and there's projected collections, but cash flow wise, as we're actually right now repaying the loan, cash flow, we really won't have significant cash flow available probably till later next year in the second part of 2016. So it is best to, where it qualifies, it is best to look to the transportation bond for funding.
But we could repay it with SPLOST 7. Money.
Sure. Well, once this dollars come in.
Maybe by the time it gets designed, then there would be SPLOST funding to construct it.
Yeah, it's a matter of timing, and there are collections sure. come in the next 12 to 18 months.
Any other discussion?
How long does a design typically take?
Well, Don will have to go out and get quotes. That's, and then the board will have to award. That's going to be a couple of months at least. So.
But not.
And then it's going to take 120 days to design them. We're talking, you know, 6 to 8 months.
If you have to, you hold it a few months till it comes in.
Yeah, but it'll be designed.
It'll be designed. We start looking at the project.
You're going to do it eventually. I
yeah. Understand.
At that point, we will still have right-of-way and easement acquisition, which is not a big dollar item.
Takes time.
That'll take another 6 months, possibly. So hopefully by the time design's done and right-of-way acquisition's complete, those SPLOST 7 funds for construction will be available. If not, the board can decide at that time if they want to use the bond funds
to construct.
Yes.
Guessing at 1.8 million.
Very well. Okay. Are we here motion for this?
I'll make a motion that we direct engineering to go out for design for the Category B SPLOST 7 projects, Northern Oak Drive to Melody Miser Lane, Dave's Creek Park to Old Atlanta Road, and bring their design quotes back to the board.
Second.
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Bond. Have a motion second to move forward with design. Any other questions? Presented by Commissioner Tam. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Carries 5-0.
I just think at some point we ought to get a, you know, I know everybody's got a lot on their plate, but if there's, you know, some $55 million in this category here that is overlapped with the bond, you know, where's the funding come from? Is it coming from the bond or is it coming from the SPOS? And if it's coming from the bond, then at some point you move to category B because you got to have the money.
If it ends up coming from SPLOST, then they may have to borrow as much as
the bond. So the SPLOST should have to pull as much from the bond. Yeah. You're absolutely right.
But I think it's just around $25 million that overlaps, and there's not 50, obviously.
Well, I've got,
Or that was what John
said. Well, if you have Castleberry Road on there, too, which was is half B, half A.
Yeah.
It's just round number up.
We really need, at some point, for Dave to...
Sure. And that's what I'm saying.
So there's no guessing, so we know exactly.
Yeah, we can put that on another work session.
Right.
Okay.
We really need that looked at very closely, so there's no guessing.
Yep, I agree.
That's right, because there's a dozen or so intersection improvements for this plus B, and we have the money.
Item 16, Councilor.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, this is an update with respect to the sign code moratorium and possible board action. I'll say at the outset, I'm not prepared for you to take action today, but I think I am going to be in a position for you to take action at the next regular meeting. And candidly, I know we might wait till a work session, but given the sensitivity of signage and the fact that we've got a complete moratorium, I think it would be, I mean, obviously the board can suggest to me otherwise, but it might make sense for us to get the moratorium lifted to the extent we can as quickly as we can. And so the good news is that we have reviewed all of our sign code in light of the Reed versus Gilbert decision and believe that it looks really good. In fact, there's only a few things that we feel like we need to change. I'll go over them with you very quickly. I think we do now need to meet with Mr. Brown and talk to him about a recommendation involving the definition of a discontinued sign. I just can't tell you that in light of the Reed decision, how exactly we've got to be to try and ferret out any content-based language in our code. And right now, our definition of discontinued signs and the way we implement the notion of a discontinued signs pertains to a business, the activity of which has ceased operation. Well, the only way you could know whether that activity has ceased operation is what, in fact, the content or the message in the sign is. And so we have to be very, very careful with that in light of the strict scrutiny test that Gilbert set up. So we will be looking at that language. We also have a definition of expression sign that while the language is intended to ensure that it is treated as a catch-all, it does provide that the sign is not related to a particular use of land. The reason for that was to differentiate it from the overwhelming majority of the signs that are not. They are triggered by a use of land, but the message does not have to relate to whatever the use of land is. And so it was a means of trying to distinguish an expression sign from the other sort of signage. Nonetheless, when I bring this back, you will likely see that definition streamlined. We have in the sign code something called a kiosk sign. Years ago, the county dabbled with the notion of a kiosk sign program that were going to be basically county-owned signs that would allow residential direction signs in a right-of-way. I think Cherokee County has a version of this. We never did it. We never implemented it. Probably need to take that out. There's an exemption we have for signs pertaining to the time a business activity or establishment is open. Well, if we have an exemption in our sign code that is for signage that identifies the times and dates that a business is open, then therefore we have made an accommodation based upon the content of the message. And Reed versus Gilbert, we can't do that. So it's sort of those very, very fine points that we'll be bringing this back to you. My expectation is, and what I'll bring back to you at the next regular meeting, is a resolution that would lift the moratorium in full, but would then place a moratorium on enforcement of those elements of the sign code that we think are troublesome. And then while we've got that in place, we'll bring to you formal ordinance modification to strip those from the code.
Okay. Mr. Brown, have you had many people complain about the moratorium yet, or apply for signs?
Well, we had a rush just before the moratorium went in place, but since then it's been fairly quiet.
And that rush was mainly billboards, wasn't it?
It's about 50-50.
50-50?
Yeah.
Okay, Counselor, thank you for that update. Item 17, electronic boards. Counselor?
Mr. Chairman, yeah, this is obviously talking about signs still, but we're talking about something a little differently. This is a matter that the Board of Commissioners had on its public hearing agenda last Thursday, pertaining to Section 4.15, electronic message boards. We had been grappling with the notion of allowing electronic message boards for properties that had a principal use that is either a religious facility, college, university, private or parochial school, hospital, military or veterans organization, or nonprofit organization. We had also had some language in there that stated that before an entity that had that use on its property would be eligible, they had to have a minimum of 100 foot of frontage along a 4-lane or greater divided public roadway. We got some feedback back with respect to that said, look, that's too ambitious, and candidly, that would take off the table a lot of institutional sorts of uses that would appreciate having that signage that are on state highways. And so I think at Thursday's meeting, the Board of Commissioners was grappling with, well, do we limit it to this 4-lane or graded public roadway, state highways, or both? And I think the board just wanted to talk about it some more. And so that's why we're here. All I need from you is direction. I mean, you've had two public hearings. You could adopt what's in your agenda book right now, candidly, if you wanted to. But if you want to change it to have sort of those both those elements, I'll need to advertise it quickly for August so we can have one more public hearing.
One of the main things, we have a lot of churches and things, community centers, little small community centers that are on two-lane county roads. And this wouldn't include those, would it?
Well, then that's correct. So you know, that's where we get to. So right now we were talking about a 4-lane divided public road or a state highway, but if we even want to go to a 2-lane county road, I mean, I just need some direction on how broad or narrow you want to make this accommodation available.
Of course, Ms. Remus, this is not just for churches, so there are other uses in here.
Not sure. I'm just taking out church and some community centers, things like that. There are on.
Yeah, it started with
VFW. School,
I mean, that was who brought it.
Yeah.
The first one that brought it was the VFW, and they, because it said it had to be a 4-lane road, they couldn't put up a sign.
But do you want to include, I know if you want to go to 2-lane roads, I'd probably go along with that, but do you want to include all the institutional uses as well?
I find it hard not to, because some of these places have been on back roads, not back roads, but 2-lane roads for many years, and we're changing the sign ordinance. Some of them may have message board signs now, I don't know. I haven't ridden on every road lately.
Well, you're thinking on Castleberry Road, Mauldin has been covered pretty soon.
And Bethany. But I think we need to look after the institutions that's on two-lane roads.
They should be excluded.
Can we work some
board? Well, I mean, if the board wants, for instance, right now it says has a minimum of 100 feet of frontage along a 4-lane or greater divided public roadway. If we just put has a minimum of 100 feet of frontage along a 2-lane or greater public roadway,
that should cover
that's done it. Now that's going to obviously impact a lot more roads, which I think is what the board has in mind. And I'll advertise this, get it on the website, and we'll have another public hearing in August.
Sounds good.
With the board, would y'all really give me that?
Will this be limited to a zoning category, or just anybody who wants to put up a sign?
It is in commercial and industrial zoning districts.
Did you catch that, Jim?
Yes, I did. Thank you.
Now, is it non? Does it have a category like nonprofit or?
No, you're right. Mr. Brown just corrected me, and he is correct. Commissioner Boff, please listen. Make sure you hear this. Right now, the electronic message boards are authorized in commercial and industrial zoning districts, or in any district where the property has the frontage and those institutional uses. So, Commissioner Boff, it would not, this, what we're talking about now would not be limited by the zoning.
And that's for existing buildings, so we could limit any new building coming up. Could we not?
You mean by way of conditions?
Yeah, by way of conditions. If we had a new zoning come up, we want to put up.
Yeah, I think we do that all the time.
Yeah.
We limit otherwise legal things, we limit it based, yes, we can do that.
Did you hear that, Mr. Boff?
Yes, I did, thank you.
Do we need a vote on that, Counselor, or you got your...
Well, I think I've got my instructions. I was going to ask for a vote. The bottom line is you all just want to limit that second tier to just a two-lane public roadway. Okay, that's what you'll see in August then.
Thank you, Counselor. I think that'll work better. One more time, item 18, alcohol.
This is why you called in, Jim, because we have an alcohol code change.
Couldn't stand to miss
I'd much rather be here than on the beach.
Board members, at the public hearing on Thursday, we had a public hearing involving the alcohol code. We had three revisions, one pertaining to movie theaters, one pertaining to breweries and brew pubs, and one pertaining to the ability of certain package stores to also have basically a consumption on the premise license as well, so long as they adhere to a carefully defined limitation on what is in fact a premise. And we started going through some scenarios. Some of the board members were asking, well, how would you do this? And would there be a requirement of two licenses? And how would the distances be calculated? And would the servers that are doing the bagging or the transactions for the package be able to pour the drinks? So we have answers for all of those. But I think the board generally wanted to kick around the concept of this anyway. And I'll tell you, is it Longacre?
Yes.
Mr. Longacre is here. He's one of the individuals that is doing sort of a market or a store that might have or drive a benefit of this sort of thing. So obviously I think he might want to come here. If you are interested in sort of the design or sort of his vision for what that looks like, you can maybe ask him some questions. But we're here, you know, we've had two public hearings on this as well. The board could adopt if it wanted to, or we could take some other options.
Okay, Mr.
Tambo,
you had quite a few questions.
I had some logistical questions. Time, I hope you can walk us through this. I'm not trying to put you on the spot, but I think I forewarned you. So,
did.
Okay, so let's just call it Target. All right, just like they have a little Starbucks in the Target. So now you're going to be able to walk into this little section and get a beer or a glass of wine.
Yes.
So who holds the license? Is it a separate license? Somebody operating, I'm just going to say that little Starbucks section, which is now beer and wine.
Yes, it would be two.
Go ahead.
We'd issue two licenses, two separate outlets. In your hypothetical, the Target would have a package license. The Starbucks would have a consumption license. They each would have their own name licensee. Could be the same person. But each application needs to have a name licensee identified, and they would each pay their own fees.
Okay, so it's $4,400 roughly for that little outlet to
Beer and wine by the package is $1,500, and beer and wine for consumption is also $1,500.
Okay.
I'm assuming there's no distilled spirits, so I'm thinking it applies for that.
What happens if the little Starbucks, Commissioner Townsend, gets four infractions within 2 years? Does that involve the big store to the little store? What's that difference there?
It would, I'll start off with what I see in my department, like Ken add to it. I see it as being independent unless the commissioner saw something in conducting that administrative hearing that you thought there was overlap. You thought they were tied either by the name licensee or the employees or the operations of the business. Because there are going to be operational aspects we haven't encountered before, being that these outlets would be within the same building. So it would start off independent. It would have the potential to be combined if you saw justification for that, is my thought.
I think that it presents a real challenge. I mean, I agree with everything Tom said, but I think we all know that a certain number of infractions within a two-year period typically results in an automatic revocation of the license. And I think there's some language in our code that says if your license is revoked, that premise can't get another license for a certain number of years. So I think if we got near to that track, I mean, it might end up disqualifying the entire premise from getting a license.
So do we want to let them be able to put both those licenses in the name of one licensee for their own protection?
The way it's drafted right now, they have the option of using the same name on both.
just like a Publix grocery store today, they have multiple outlets in the county. It's up to them if they choose to have one individual on multiple licenses or not.
And commissioners, if someone put the license in two separate names and you felt they were doing that to avoid the cumulative effect, that would you typically would not like that. Because, I mean, I think that that puts the burden on that license holder to be ultra, ultra strict, lest they run up three very quickly.
Tom, I thought also that the license holder, the license for that was tied to an actual real address. How can you have an area inside of a building and two licenses and two license holders with one address?
The language, and I'll let Ken answer that, but I believe the language he drafted covers that.
It does. I mean, that's exactly right. And so obviously the premise, which is what we're how we're doing this, we're trying to define it in a way that gets around what I think is Georgia law on this. You know how we've grappled with this through the years. But it does it by a new definition of premise that makes it a, you know, aesthetically and architecturally distinguishable area within a otherwise, you know, bricks and mortar building that would have its own separate license. Now, obviously, would the address of that premise be the same address for the otherwise bricks and mortar structure? Yes, it would be.
How does a, and I've seen a Kroger or something have a Starbucks with that.
Yes.
Are they writing a lease specifically giving them X amount of square feet or X amount of square feet in a certain area of their within their building? How does that work? And if they do have that lease, should the county use that part of that lease as a separation when they're doing a licensing?
Well, I will say I understand your point, because the notion is if they have a separate vendor come in and run the consumption element of their market, if that vendor gets three infractions, should that result in taking away the whole market as well and everybody? Is that your thought?
No, and I'm saying maybe it shouldn't, and this is how you get around it, because they're going to have a separate lease. They don't have an address per se different, but there is a physical description of the area in which they're leasing that could be held, and that's how you separate.
That's true, but I mean, how many times have we had a leaseholder that runs the gas food market that comes in front of you, and you all have wanted to get the owner of that establishment in here to make sure that the owner is appropriately vetting their tenants to ensure that, I mean, my only point being is it does put some skin in the game for the owner to be diligent that the vendor selling the consumption alcohol is doing so in a responsible way.
I also think we may not always see a lease example. When we started off talking about a Target Starbucks example, I think you'd have that there. The example we have in front of us that came to the commissioners, I don't think you're going to see a lease in that example.
Unless he has a separate LLC for it, I don't know.
Could be.
But I know the owner aspect comes into play there, Ken, obviously, because they're leasing a little area within their same address. And they mess up to where they lose that license ability, that leased little address, and they can't put somebody else in there, so they do have skin in the game.
Agreed.
Let me ask this question, counsel. I know alcohol sales, wine or beer, or spirits are based on like a bar of food compared to license porter. Like, how do we, I mean, a grocery store, so they go into the deli, the grocery store, and they buy the sandwich at the deli, go through and pay for it, and walk over to the little wine part and have a glass of wine and eat the sandwich. I mean, it just sounds...
What they're going to have to do, and this is where we're going to have to be rigorous in our enforcement, is the way this is set up is that this premise, we're calling it a premise, and I think I had y'all some slides that showed like a discrete area within otherwise in a package store, which is just what a grocery store is, if you think of it in the alcohol vernacular, it's a package store, is that they'll have to sell 50% of food at that location. So that's going to be a lot of sandwiches.
Can you require them to have stanchions or some kind of divider or some sort where there's plants or little indoor fencing or something that has some kind of separation that specifically separates it?
Well, how we drafted it was a structurally and visibly defined area. Now, I did not get into architectural specifics, but the point you're making is the point we tried to capture, right, is that it's supposed to look, you know, when you're entering it.
That's reasonable.
Right.
And of course, then they have a little bit of problem with enforcement. What, whose opinion, what's separation and what's enough or it's not enough.
But that's a matter for code enforcement and Mr. Brown to maybe work through from the implementation. And if it's broken or if there's a problem, you know, we love back. Going back to the board with alcohol code modifications. I mean, it's what we do, right?
Any other questions? Council, do you need to bring it back for another public hearing? Can we take
action? You can take action. You can take action today. You've had your two public hearings.
Does everybody feel comfortable with this written? I mean, Council.
The only thing I'm a little hesitant on is who holds the license. You know, I'm almost thinking that the guy who has the building should hold the license inside of there. What's to say that, you know, my grocery store is going a little slow, so I'm just going to sublet a little 1,000 square feet over 400, 500 square foot corner over here to somebody that's going to sell beer and wine. Just to see if I can up my activity. Well, if a guy's selling beer and wine, how's he selling food?
You know? Well, they have to, though. Do they not?
They do.
He can sell fireworks.
True. Just don't shoot off
your head. Jim, you okay?
More often.
Blast.
No. Well, they were supposed to sell the food. They have to create that somehow. Then they have to have a kitchen. They have to go through all kinds of process.
And
the man that owns an overall building, the individual or corporate owns an overall building, still has skin in the game, because if they want to do that to make some money off that corner, then they need that license to maintain and not lose that corner to be able to have that license.
Well, we could always come back and change it if it continues with a problem, could we tell? I mean, if it shows it's going to be a problem having two licensees.
Yes, we could come back for sure.
So are these folks inspected by the health department because they have to sell food?
The same, that would be like any other food vendor.
Four department sink.
Oh, yeah. If they're willing to do all that,
three straps, sauce fans.
Interesting, isn't it? Yeah. But that's not what we should be getting into, so.
That's right. Well, it's just monitoring that certain amount of food sales.
It's
going to
be tough.
Go ahead.
Do you feel comfortable going? Go ahead. Take back to public here.
No public hearing, Mr. Chairman. I mean, y'all could just take the action today.
Yeah. I know.
Oh, forgive me. Yes, sir.
In all reality, if this is mostly for tasting, to see what you want to purchase, there's not a whole lot of consumption going on to be able to meet that 15% goal, if that's what it's used for.
What kind of store do you have?
Would you like to see?
What's the name of the store? What is
Long Acres Market. It is going to be incredibly unique, not only to Georgia, but to the United States. I'm doing all local. I've already got 14 farmers already signed up, doing everything from local honey to grass-fed beef, and it's here right around the corner and coming. And basically what I approached the commissioner's office with was just an opportunity to have, this is going to be a destination place. It's not going to be you're going into Kroger, buying a gallon of milk and coming out. Basically what I wanted to do was create an experience where if you've never been to Cherry Street Brewery and I've got their growler on there featuring their Red Eye Jedi made around the corner, before you invest $20 in the growler, you should be allowed to have a little taste in it and figure out what food goes with that, and I'll have an expert there. It'll be staffed. It's certainly not... I have no ambition to run it like a bar type thing, and the same thing with the wine. A mnemonic system, which is a very expensive system, monitors the ounces and get you a chance to try a Chateau Montalena by the ounce before you spend $50 to buy it by the bottle. And that's what I'm trying to create is a very unique opportunity in this neighborhood. And there's no other store like that in the state. And all I'm asking for is an equal playing field with Whole Foods that can do that throughout the state and throughout the United States, is they're offering wine and beer while you're in there shopping. And I don't expect it on that larger of a scale, but I changed the design of the store to specifically go with Ken's recommendations, and it's visible, it's structured. And that's really what I'm looking for, the complete package, and all of this is going to be as much as I can through Georgia and everything else
that I can buy from Georgia.
Do you want to tell us where your facility is going to be located, just this location?
Yes, sir. It's Windermere Parkway, right near Atlanta Fitness. It's a parcel that's been vacant since they built it in 2008. And it's in a great neighborhood, perfect demographics. Everybody that I've shown the designs to and everything else, I mean, it's going to be unlike any other store that you would see.
Just a couple logistics questions. So I walk in there and I sip the wine, I'll have a bottle. Do I have to walk out of there and go buy the bottle at the out of the retail establishment?
Yes.
Because
yes.
I can't buy it there where
that's correct.
Where I tasted it.
That's correct.
You also mentioned that you taste food with it. Are you going? We have a strict food alcohol ordinance.
Mm-hmm.
Are you charging for the food tastings to make up for the revenue?
Absolutely. Well, we're charging for both. We can charge for both. I mean, you're providing the tasting, but there will be a tapas menu that you can order with food if you choose to sit down. Plus, you can order a salad or a sandwich from the deli, and then there's going to be a minimal amount of seating. You were mentioning about the difference between the health department and the Department of Agriculture. It's based on the number of seats that you have. So we're limiting the amount of seats that you have. It's not going to be a big deli area that seats 40 and everything else. It's a very small, quaint, intimate little area.
Will you also be doing samples of the food and cheeses for them to buy that as well?
Absolutely. That's a huge part of a specialty store is sampling and tasting everything.
Not just the beer and wine, but foods as well.
Correct. And I already have the farmers that will produce the white marble pork and the grass-fed beef that will come out and cook it and have the consumers try it on the property.
Will you let me visit?
Absolutely.
You don't have much you can eat.
Yeah, you take
it. But it's going to charge me, so it's
not free. Not for those samples, no. Not for the sample.
Well, what's our decision? Are we satisfied the way it's written by council? Council would just take action to approve it?
You can. So you take action. I don't think it needs to be time sensitive. It'll just go on the next consent agenda.
I'll make a motion that we approve the modification of the alcohol code regarding allowing consumption of premises license with an establishment that has a package license. That's presented by attorney.
Second.
Motion second for approval. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Ms. Boff? All opposed?
Aye.
Okay.
Aye.
Aye. You're in. So carries 5-0. Item 19, Counselor. UDC changes.
Mr. Chairman, board members, thank you. This was added on a time-sensitive basis. And I just wanted to get the board's feedback. We have some language in Section 18 of Unified Development Code pertaining to what we're requiring on final plats. If you look, and I know you don't have it in front of you, so I'll try to read it to you as best I can, but if you look in Section 18, 6.4, we have requirements that in addition to just a litany of obligations under, there's a certain table 18.2 that contains a lot of the requirements in final plats. We require a surveyor's certificate, which the final plat's already going to be stamped by the surveyor. We require a surveyor's certificate. We require an owner's certificate, and we require all of this information to be notarized. And we have just received, I think this is Mr. Brown and others, have received some feedback from the profession saying, you know, we're already covered by a state statute on the Plat Act, we're already covered by this fairly healthy Section 18.2 of your code, by requiring these owners to have to complete the certification and notarize it. In many instances, we're asking them to notarize things they don't even know are accurate or not, and they're already, you know, sort of duplicative to the extent that there's already a surveyor's professional seal and stamp on the final plat anyway. Would there be any interest in the Board of Commissioners to initiating a UDC modification to taking out some of these additional certifications that we're just getting some pushback that these are just unnecessary and candidly quite time consuming? So I'm just bringing it to you. For instance, just so you can give you an idea. So the owner certification says on a final plat, the owner of the land shown on this plat and whose name is subscribed here too, in person or through a duly authorized agent, certifies that this plat was made from an actual survey and that all state and local taxes or other assessments now due in the land have been paid.
Said owner donates and dedicates to the public for use forever the street right-of-way as shown on this plat, with a place for the owner to sign it, and then a notary public to also sign it. So, you know, that's the sort of information that we're asking to be placed on the actual final plat.
We have to go through the public hearing for this?
We would, for the planning commission and the board of commissions.
And there's, the surveyor's saying there's no way the owner knows that.
Well, with respect to, was made from an actual survey, certifies this plat was made from an actual survey. Candidly, if they retain the surveyor, I suppose they would know that. But I suppose some have raised it that they don't know it. Doesn't seem like it's so far-fetched, they would have no clue, however.
Well, where did this come from? Yeah. And what, I remember when it was brought up from the surveyors, and they're saying, help me remember why it's, they said this created such a problem.
It is unnecessary, in their opinion, it's unnecessary, and in fact, we may be asking somebody to notarize things that they physically can't notarize.
They are saying sign it.
Yeah,
right.
We're asking them to falsify documents.
Well,
we're asking them. I remember all the surveyors
that was one
said
of the assertions. That's right. And it's just not necessary. The surveyor says that if we have to put a certification on here, our license, our signature, our professional responsibility is for the accuracy of this, and the other certifications and endorsements you're asking for are unnecessary.
Tom, did I get that right?
I'm sorry.
Yes.
A while back, we had somebody who falsified inspections. Do we require notarization of inspection reports currently?
Do we have, Tom, did you hear that?
No.
No, we do not. Do not, Jim.
Well, you know, I don't know that notarization might have stopped that, but that's a case where we don't have notarization. And we got a bunch of bogus inspections.
That's true.
True. Do you want to add that to our discussion, Mr. Boff?
Well, I just don't know. Certainly, I think we've had stuff approved under this horrendous old method, and I don't know that we're fixing anything by eliminating this.
But I think what their complaint was, and help me if I'm, because we met so long ago that I'm fading on what their complaint was, but we're asking them to, like, they're saying that what they stamp, that they're putting their license, that everything, that when they put their stamp on it, they're saying, they're attesting, they're putting their everything on the line.
Yes.
It's like the engineer stamping. The person they sue is the surveyor engineer. They don't sue the notary public.
Right. And that other document, like they can't attest to something that is not.
Yes, for
their
work.
It
was both.
Well, but that's true for everything that a notary does.
One additional challenge is many of these property owners will be out of state or at least outside the county.
I mean, essentially, aren't we just questioning if we should ever have anything notarized ever because the notary doesn't have any idea what it says?
Well, no, okay, no. Let me break. I think we're crossing. I want to make sure we're speaking. A notary does something different than the surveyor or the owner. So the notary is only attesting to the identity of who is actually affixing their name.
Signing the paper.
So I don't know that we need to. I mean, you know, if we want to go down that path, we can. But I think candidly, it's more. I mean.
Why do we care about the identity on some documents but not this one?
Well, Tom, correct me if I'm wrong here. I think there are three different issues on a plat. One is a surveyor's seal and signature and date. The second is a signature, a surveyor certification. And the third is an owner's certification.
Yes.
And what the surveyor is saying is, look, my seal, my stamp, my signature is all that is required by Georgia state law. The other certifications, the certification you require me to put and the certification by the owner, are unnecessary. They delay the project. they add expense to the project. They're simply not necessary. And I think that's the crux of the issue now. Gentlemen, correct me if that's...
Let me just add to that real quick, and I want to hear from Tom Brown, obviously. The table 18.2 is our plat requirements, and it requires that a plat contain the land surveyor's stamp, certificate, signature, including field survey and closure statements. So we have that, and then we've got this language following the UDC that says, in addition to that, we require this. And so I think it's the this, it's that additional paragraph that I think the surveyors are saying, why do I have to do that when I've already done and placed my seal on the document?
Right.
I think that's...
They're saying that that's the legal document, but that's recognized by the state of Georgia.
The notarization actually protects them as much as anybody else against somebody coming in and fraudulently signing their name.
That's what notaries do.
But I don't think the notarization, they don't care about the notarization.
That's not required on the surveyors. That's only required on the owners.
Well, if their credibility's on the line, I don't know why they wouldn't care.
Yeah, but that's not...
Well, the owner will no longer sign the plat, so the need for notarizing a signature disappears when there is no signature to notarize. So if we're comfortable with the owner's signature being removed, I think that's the real issue, and then there is no need for a notary once you get to that point. But I do agree with the summary of what I heard today from that meeting we had with the surveyors. It was my summary of it was there's no value added, but there's a lot of hard work putting it all together for a little or no value added process.
It protects the owner. Supposing somebody comes and decides they want to survey somebody's land or present a survey, and for somebody who doesn't live in the county but owns some land and comes in and all of a sudden you got a potential final plat being built and the owner doesn't know it.
Did you hear that, Mr. Brown?
I did, and...
They have to sign the application, the zoning application.
The danger there is that for the surveyor, I can tell you, we sat with a room full of surveyors and they were not concerned about that.
Not at all. They're the ones that wanted it taken out.
Well, they're not the landowner. Why would they be concerned?
But wouldn't they have their professional license at risk if they were to submit a survey for action to the county and owner wasn't aware of it?
Can you give an example where a surveyor has license revoked for doing something they shouldn't do?
No, they were the group that came asking for it to be changed.
I understand.
What was
they're
the
saying event? We don't want to put our license at risk. Is it theirs?
Well, do y'all want to have a public hearing about this?
Probably
that's
should.
All. That's all we do is
that's
have a public hearing.
Should.
Mr. Boff, do you mind having a public hearing about this? Jim?
I don't.
Okay. Would y'all mind doing that? We've been discussing that.
They wanted it.
They wanted a public hearing. They can come defend it if they want to.
They can come talk. That's right.
Counselor?
Okay. Then that would be to start at least the public hearing process with respect to the removal of this language. And if there's no input or whatever, then board will take action as it deems appropriate at the end of that process.
I mean, it was Neil McCorder, it was Buzzy Bennett, it was Jake Page, it was Richard Webb. I mean, it was a good representation of about eight.
Well, let them come and speak to us.
Yeah. I don't know if any of them will show up, but it was seven or eight that were here.
Council, do we need a motion for that?
You send things to public hearing, I do like a motion.
I'll make a motion by sending this to the public hearing.
Second.
Motion is second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Ain't opposed.
Aye.
Carries 4-1. Council, is there a need for an executive session?
Chairman, there is.
Come on.
Do I have a motion to recess to work session and enter to an executive session for the purpose of discuss litigation, land acquisition, and our personnel?
Move.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Take a little break.
Carries 5-0. We stand recess at 3:38. We will re-adjourn at 3:45. Did you hear that, Mr. Boff?
Yes, thank you.
3:45.
7 whole minutes?
Thank you. Jim, you must call you back. Yeah, go ahead and take a break. Thank you, Jim.
Okay.
still know what it is, how to work on that.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. I just want to make one.
I'm just going to make one.